The Ramayana was originally written by the sage Valmiki. He was divinely inspired and he wrote the Ramayana before the descent of Lord Ram. So when the Supreme Lord descended, he was actually waiting for him to witness his pastimes. Valmiki ji writes, Loke nahi sa vidyeta yo na rama manubrataha. He says, there is no human being on this planet Earth who is not a devotee of my Ishtadev Shri Ram. We can say he said it out of sentiments, his own devotional feelings. But 500 years ago, the next great devotee of Lord Ram, sage Tulsidas, who translated that Ramayana into Hindi, and the Ram Charitmanas that he wrote is one of the greatest literary works in humankind in terms of the knowledge, the literary tools that he has used. He corroborates Valmiki ji's statement by saying, Asko jeeva jantu jagmahi jehi raghunath pran priya nahi. He includes not just human beings but all living beings and says, for all living beings, Raghunath is their very life air. So these statements are not just mere emotional outpourings, but they are based on hard facts. The fact is, the personality of Sri Ram is such, he is an ocean of bliss. Jo ananda sindhu sukharasi si karte trailokya upasi. Lord Ram is an ocean of infinite bliss. And being his tiny parts, we are naturally drawn to that bliss, which is an aspect of his personality. So although in our consciousness we may be separated from him in this realm of material existence, yet we are tied to him by the string of the yearning for happiness. It's like a farmer ties the cow with a rope. So the cow goes around grazing, but it has to remain in the periphery of that rope. So similarly, we human beings and living beings in this world, although engaged in varieties of pursuits, are still within the leash of God. And nobody can break that leash, no matter what they do. In other words, we may try for infinite ages, but nobody can break our natural propensity for bliss. It is unchangeable. People may engage in meditations, they may engage in a variety of pursuits, but the nature of bliss is inherent to the soul. Just like the nature of fire is heat and light. And as long as that propensity for bliss remains, we will remain leashed to God and we will keep searching for Him. Now this search for God, we have understood why we need to search for Him. what is the importance of the day we are celebrating, which is Ram Navami, in this search? The Western world is not familiar with the concept of a personal form of God. The concept of God devoid of attributes, devoid of forms, finds universal acceptance in all cultures, in all countries around the world. If you say God is light, everybody is comfortable with it. But if you say that God can go take on a form and walk down the marketplace, walk into a mall and drink maybe a Pepsi or something, that concept would be indigestible to most people in the Western world. Whereas in our culture, it is natural. We people relish such pastimes of God, where His almightiness gets hidden and He comes to the level of the devotee. So the fact is that God is all things. This whole world has been created by Him, we all know. Not only that, He Himself has become this world. In other words, like a spider takes the web out of itself and then withdraws it back in itself. So the Vedas say, yathorna nabhihi srijate grihnate cha yatha prithivya moshadaya sambhavanti yatha satah purushat keshalomani tatha ksharat sambhavatiha vishvam. It's just like the hair growing out of our body is an aspect of our body itself. It's just like the mud converts into trees that manifest on the earth. And just like the web comes out of the spider, in the same way the Munduk Upanishad states, God Himself has become this world. In other words, it is His energy that He has expanded and manifested in this form. So if He can take on the myriad forms and shapes and qualities and attributes that we see in existence, is it not possible for Him to take on a form for Himself? Why this restraint? Why this constraint in our thinking? So the infinite God has infinite possibilities. And the ability to take on a form is just one aspect of that possibilities. But when He takes on the form, He enhances His own bliss and He enhances the bliss of His devotees. Just like if a wife could not ever see her husband, how terribly boring it would be. So now, when the wife has the husband's qualities, activities, etc., it adds so much sweetness to the relationship. So similarly, when God manifests in His personal form, the whole field of devotion becomes immensely sweeter, because that same God, you are able to now see Him. You are able to witness His wonderful qualities. You are able to observe, participate in His divine pastimes. And each of these aspects of His personality is incredibly sweet. It is so sweet that it's beyond the ability of expression of poets and saints. Sage Tulsidas says, Soi sukha lavalesh bar ikajin sapne ulaheu te nahi ganahi khages brahma sukhahi sajjan sumati. He says, the divine love bliss of the personal form of God is so immensely sweet that if you experienced a drop of it in your dream, sapnehu lehyu lavalesh, a drop of it in your dream, you would get detached from the ocean of bliss of the formless aspect of God. You would never ever imagine giving up devotion to the personal form to attach yourself to the formless. If you had a glimpse of its bliss in your dream itself. These are mere expressions that these saints have used. The Hari Bhakti Sudhodhaya says, Sukhani Ghosh Padayante Brahmanyapi Jagat Guru says, to compare the bliss of the formless aspect of God with the bliss of His personal form is like comparing the amount of water in the hoof print of a calf with that of the ocean. He permits all of us to relish that bliss, to taste it, to enjoy it, not for now, but for the rest of eternity. But we need to know how to take out bliss from that treasure chest that He brings with us when He descends in this world. So before we learn how to open up that treasure chest of divine love bliss, we need to first of all address some basic questions regarding God's personal form and His descension into the world. For example, when God does descend, when Sri Ram came into this world, was He born from a mother's womb, like human children are? Did He remain for 9 months in the womb of Kaushalya? Or did He just manifest from outside? So, people would say, well, you know, if God is going to be born, He will be born from the mother's womb. Where else is He going to be born from? So we must remember that God, if He was to be born, then He would also die. And if God is going to undergo the cycle of birth and death, then He is like any of us. Then there is nothing special about Him. Why should we worship Him? So the Bhagavad Gita clarifies this point where Sri Krishna says, Arjun, Bahuni me vyatitani janmani tava charchuna. You have had many births. I have also had many births. I am right now in front of you in the age of Dwapar as Lord Krishna, and I came in Treta as Lord Ram, and I have had many, many births. But there is a distinction between your birth and my birth, and that distinction is very important. So he says, janma karma cha me divyam evam yo veti tatvatah tyaktva deham punarjanma naiti mameti sorjuna. He says, Arjuna, your birth is material. And your karmas, your activities are also material. My birth is divine and my activities are also divine. So these avatars that take place, they have divine births. You see, this is an important assertion in Christian literature, the divine birth of Jesus. But our Vedic literature states the same for Sri Ram, for Sri Krishna. The Ramayana very clearly states, the Ramcharitmanas, that when Sri Ram manifested in front of Mother Kaushalya, it was not as a little baby. He manifested in his four-armed Sri Vishnu form, 6 feet tall. Now, could that six-foot form have come out of the mother's womb? Is that possible? And to think about it in his four arms, in one of the arms, Vishnuji holds the Sudarshan disc, the divine disc, which is the sharpest thing in the world. Now, with that kind of disc, if he had sat in Mother Kaushalya's womb, imagine her discomfort. She would probably have had an automatic operation. So it is very obvious that he did not manifest from her womb. He came from outside, and Kaushalya admitted. She realized that you are not my child. I am your child. You are my supreme father. And I know why you came. Because in previous lifetimes I had requested, please come as my child and give me the bliss of being your mother. However, if you have come, if you are in this form, how will I ever think that you are my child? So Kaushalya said, Ki jai shishu leela. My lord, please hide this form of yours and begin your leelas. So when God hides his original almighty personality, we call that leela. In other words, when he starts cheating. In India, there is dafa 420, fraud. If somebody commits a fraud, that person can be brought to court under this article 420. So when God commits a fraud, we call it a leela. In other words, that all-pervading God manifests in his personal form. This is a leela. The unborn God pretends to be born from Kaushalya. This is a leela. The all-knowing God pretends, I don't know, where is Sita lost? Can you please help me? This is a leela. The ever blissful God is crying in separation from Sita. Where has she gone? This is also a leela. The all-powerful God is telling Sugriv in Vibhishan, you know, this Ravan is too strong for me. I need your help, otherwise I can't get rid of him. This is also a leela. So God hides himself. And that is where the realm of leela or divine pastimes begins. So, the Ramayana states that God, when he manifested, Kaushalya said, Ki jai shishu leela ati priya shila ityadi, etc. My Lord, please begin your leelas. So God obliged. He took advantage of his divine power which is called Yoga Maya. One is Maya, the material energy, and the other is Yoga Maya, his spiritual energy. So he covered his mother with the curtain of Yoga Maya, so she may forget what she has seen. She may not remember that this is his original personality. And he covered himself as well with that Yoga Maya and became a little child. In the Bhagavad Gita, Sri Krishna calls Yoga Maya as Atma Maya. So he says, Ajo pisan avyayatma bhutanam ishvaro pisan prakritim swamadhishthaya sambhavamyatma mayaya. He says, I am Aj. Does anybody know what does Aj mean? Unborn. So he says, I am Aj, Arjun, yet by my Atma Maya, I descend in this world. So utilizing that Atma Maya, Yoga Maya, he unfolds the Leela. That full-fledged God, 6 feet in height, became a little baby. And this is where the Leela began. So when a little child is born, what is the first act? The child cries. So the Ramayana also mentions Rodan Thana, God cried. However, before that, Tulsidasji, in his amazing wisdom and insight, he says, Prabhu Musakana. After God became a little child, he smiled. And then he cried, bah. So before crying, why did he smile? He smiled to indicate that the drama is about to begin. The curtain is about to be lifted. And when the curtain was lifted, the first scene was Rodan Thana. People are seeing there is a baby born and it's crying. This is the baby of Kaushalya. That is what the world is seeing. And the fact is that God was never born to her. He is eternally unborn. He has absolutely no need to remain hanging upside down for 9 months. He may, by his Yoga Maya power, create such sensations to enhance the mother's love so that she feels that this is my child. And by his Yoga Maya, he has made her forget that she had seen him in his 6 foot form. So she truly feels that he is my child and I am his mother. Because if she remembered what she had seen earlier, she could never experience the maternal affection towards Ram. Each time she would see him, she would have folded her arms and begun the Vishnu Sahasranam. Shantakaram bhujangashayanam padmanabham suresham vishwadharam gaganasadrisham megavarnam shubhangam. How could she ever think that I am his mother? So this is the divine birth of God. The Bhagavad Gita says, to understand this concept is vitally important in cultivating your devotion. Because devotion requires divine sentiments. If you don't have divine sentiments, you cannot enhance your devotion. So even towards your guru, you keep these sentiments. Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwara. Every Indian will tell you this verse. Once I went to jail and this big prisoner with big mustaches, the IG jails, was taking me around. This, Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwara. I said, I'm very proud to know that even prisoners in India know this verse. So, this verse helps us upkeep divine sentiments towards the Guru. Similarly, when the object of our devotion is Sri Ram or Sri Krishna, that devotion is only possible when we have divine sentiments. And if we have doubts in this regard, you know, was he also born like a human child? In that case, he must have material failings in his personality like us. Then our devotion will never flourish. So Sri Krishna says in the Gita, Janma karma cha me divyam Arjun. If you can understand the divine nature of my birth and the divine nature of my activities, tyaktva deham punar janma naiti mameti swarjana, you will never have to come back in this world again. Why? Because you will succeed in your devotion. And without this understanding, you will fail in your devotion. So in order to succeed in your devotion, understand that God has a divine birth. And number two, understand that his activities are also divine. What does that mean? That means that although his pastimes, he manifests varieties of apparently material defects. Like I said, he doesn't know where Sita is. And sometimes he appears to be scared. But the Ramayana says, Bhakta hetu Bhagavan Prabhu Ram dhareu tanu bhupa kye charita pavan param prakrit nar anurupa. That he manifested in this world and revealed activities like ordinary human beings. Prakrit nar anurup. In other words, just like we people eat, God was also eating. If he had manifested in today's world, like we people take multivitamin tablets, it's possible he would have added it to his diet. Like we rest at night for 6 hours, he used to do the same. So you say, you know, God also has needs for his daily ablutions and he also goes to sleep and he also eats. Then is there any difference between him and us? And if we don't understand the difference, we will not have the foundation of our devotion will shake. But once again, with the help of knowledge and understanding, we build up that foundation. So Sri Krishna says, Janma karma cha me divyam. Arjun, my birth is divine and my activities are also divine. So these divine activities are not for mental analysis. It's a pretty stylish nowadays in India to make the leelas of Lord Ram and Lord Krishna a matter of intellectual analysis. So in Uttar Pradesh, we've got these Manas Manch. In the city of Kanpur, when I used to preach, there's about 80 different clubs in the city. And they gather every week and they discuss the leelas of Lord Ram, splitting hairs and why 3 lines, why 14 years. And they invited me to speak in one of these Manas Manches, and I said, I was horrified at what was going on. So somebody says that, why did Ram hide in Kidal-Bali? Why did he do such a terrible work? Somebody else says, come, let me tell you why I think he did this. So he gives some intellectual analysis and people say, oh, we're so delighted. Says, actually, there's no such personality as Lord Ram. It's all figurative. The whole Ramayana is to be understood metaphorically. The Ayodhya is your body and Sita is just a symbol of devotion and Hanuman is a symbol of faith. And just make it all symbolic and see how intellectually interesting it becomes. And people say, wah, 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 so nice. Today we've understood the Ramayana. So tell me something. You have understood the Ramayana? Yes, yes, yes. Panditji has explained it to me. But the Ramayana itself states, Soi janai jehi dehu janai janat tumahi tumhahi hve jai. The day you actually understand Lord Ram, you will become God-like. Janat tumahi tumhahi hve jai. So if you are still under the grip of the material energy, it's natural you have not yet understood Lord Ram. The first thing we should understand from this Ramayana is that the pastimes of God are divine and they are not a subject of intellectual analysis. The Ramayana itself states that Mother Parvati used her intellect and she suffered a downfall. Garudji used his intellect. He suffered a downfall. And we wish to display the bravery of taking our intellect there. These leelas are for engaging the mind. God has given us a mind and an intellect. He wants us to engage the mind in Him and enhance our love for Him. And to engage the intellect in the world and decide, the world is not mine. The happiness I seek is not in this world. So if we can use our mind and intellect in this manner, we will make progress and succeed. But the tendency is to do the reverse. So we absorb the mind, not in God, but in the world. We attach the mind to the world. And the intellect, we engage it in God. Why did Ram do this? Why did he not do this? So what is the end result? There was once a person who visited an Ayurvedic doctor. So he said, Vaidyaraji, I have got this irritation in my eye. And I also have a terrible pain in my stomach. So the Vaidyaraj said, you know, this your vata is inflated and the cuff is a little agitated, and accordingly he made his analysis and gave him some medicines. He said, I'm giving you this ointment. You apply it to your eye at night before sleeping. And I'm also giving you this churn powder. So you take one tablespoon and drink water over it. So he took the right medicines, but he forgot the usage. So he put the churn in his eye. And his eye swell up like a tomato. And that ointment, he took it in and drank water. So his stomach also became like a pumpkin. So the next day he went to the doctor and he said, I took the medicines that you suggested, but my situation has become very serious. So the doctor said, how did you take it? And then he realized that he had got the right medicines, but used them wrongly. So similarly, God has given us a body, a mind, and an intellect. Now the body, we are engaging in physical activities. The mind has to be purified by absorbing it in God. And the intellect has to be held with proper knowledge, with this discrimination that the world is not mine. The happiness I seek is not in the world. Now, if we reverse this, there is no scope for purifying ourselves. Hence, it is important to decide that the pastimes of Lord Ram were divine. We cannot understand them. Our intellect is so tiny, we cannot even understand our own selves. Where is the question of understanding God? But still people say that, you know, sometimes these pastimes seem to be so crazy. Why did Lord Ram reject Mother Sita on the saying of that washerman? Why did he hide and kill Bali? Why did he descend in the world in the first place? So all these questions we have in regard to why did God do this? Why did God do that? Let it all be answered once and for all so that this question never comes up again. God has got only one reason behind all his activities. We also have only one reason behind all our activities. What is the reason behind our activities? Why do we do anything? We are searching for happiness. And until we get that happiness, anything we do, whether it's social service, whether it's humanitarian work, no matter how much we may pretend to be selfless, in search of our own happiness, because we've not yet got it. And once we get that happiness, now the goal has been reached. The journey is complete. Now whatever we do will not be for our happiness, but for the happiness of others. So the God-realized saints, whatever they do is for the happiness of others. Before that, whatever we do is for our own happiness. Now God himself is an ocean of bliss. He has no need for bliss from outside. So because he is complete in himself, anything he does is for the bliss, for the welfare, for the elevation, for the salvation of the souls. So all the activities he did in his pastimes as Sri Ram, there was only one reason behind it: for human welfare. Now, it's a different matter that we may not understand what was the welfare behind it. Why did he have to hide and kill Bali? What was the welfare activity? We may not understand the specific cause, but the general principle we need to understand is that whatever he did was for human welfare. When he revealed his pastimes in the age of Treta, he knew that these pastimes will form the basis of devotion for not millions but billions of souls who are going to follow. In the last numerous centuries, billions and billions of human beings have utilized the same pastimes of Sri Ram as the basis of their devotion. You have in every household, okay, now it's a Thursday, we have to do the Sundarkand part, Mangal Bhavan, Mangalahari, they're going on and on and on, remembering the pastimes. So when Lord Ram revealed those pastimes, he knew that utilizing these pastimes, numerous souls will engage in devotion to purify themselves. So in his avatar, in his descension, he revealed his divine name, his divine form, his divine pastimes, his divine abode, his divine associates, his divine qualities, and he presented the paraphernalia for devotion for the souls of the world. So in his descension period, he did not save anybody. Tulsidas ji says, Ram ek tapas tiya tari. Lord Ram, in 11,000 years, saved one Ahilya, the wife of the ascetic Gautam. So he saved one Ahilya. But Naam Koti Khal Kumati Sudhari. He left his name here, Ram Naam. And taking the support of that Ram Naam, Koti Kumati Sudhari, in countless souls have saved themselves. Why? Because they have kept divine sentiments towards that name Ram and divine sentiments towards his pastimes. So in these names, pastimes, attributes, abodes, etc., God has presented to humankind a simple basis for devotion and a sweet basis for devotion. So that is the purpose of his descension. So when we celebrate his birthday, as we would say in the world, or Avatar Ram Navami, these are all providing us opportunities to remember his glories, to remember his names, forms, attributes, pastimes, and in this way to cultivate and to nourish our devotion. So we are all tiny parts of God, who is the ocean of bliss. And that is why our natural propensity is to seek bliss. But one of the most prominent aspects of our personality is what? The desire for love. That is the human nature. And why is this? Because that's one of the most prominent aspects of God's personality. In English, they say God is love. So that loving nature of his is one of his most important dimensions. And the sweetest bliss that we experience from him is through that love, through that devotion. So on, while remembering Sri Ram, we wish to access that love that he holds and that he makes available to us. So it is important to discuss that love, that devotion as well. It is so powerful in his personality that he himself gets bound by it. The Supreme Almighty loses his almightiness and becomes enslaved by that devotee who possesses love. So Tulsidas ji says, Vyapaka Brahma Niranjana Nirguna Vigata Vinoda. He says, Vyapak, God is all pervading. Niranjan, without any attributes, nirgun, without qualities. However, look at the humorous twist to this. Nirguna vigata vinod, so aj prema bhagati bas kaushalya ke god. That unborn God, you will find him residing in the lap of Kaushalya. Why? Prema bhagati vash. Because he is captivated by love. So the love of Mother Kaushalya is such that it has completely eliminated the almightiness of God and made him into a little child residing in her lap to relish, to have that give and take of love with his devotee. So, although God displays varieties of pastimes in his avatar, the most important pastime is his revelation that he is under love. And any devotee who has love, God is willing to become a slave of that devotee. Now, how many of you would really like to do service if you had a choice? You would rather be self-employed, you'd rather be your own boss. But then if you don't have options, you have to serve. But that service also is not a lifelong obligation. If the boss is insulting you, say, forget it, it's not worth it, I'm searching for another job. But God doesn't get discharged from his service. He becomes the eternal servant of his devotee. For the rest of eternity, he is willing to serve his devotee. If that devotee possesses love. So what is this love? The Hare Ram, we all did. That is also an expression of devotion. But is God enslaved by it? Absolutely not. Otherwise, he would have revealed himself right here. So that love we are talking about is his special divine power. It's his highest power. He has so many powers. Somebody was, you know, we went to the ashram recently. Many people went to have Maharaji's darshan. Then somebody was sharing his experience. He said, you know, I just kind of had an enhanced experience, like a booster dose. So I said, that's what Kripaluji Maharaj does. He's got those abilities. He can just boost up your powers of devotion or something based on the surrender. So God has got infinite powers. And anything that we are doing is a result of his powers. So the highest power of God is devotion. It's such a power that God is under it. Every other power is under God. And there is one power which is above God, and that is the power of devotion. So this is called Siddh Bhakti, pure love, pure divine love. And that we cannot achieve through our practice. We don't cultivate it, we don't develop it. It is his power and he gives it, if he ever so decides. And it is also the last thing that he ever gives. He will test out and see that is this soul eligible? Because when I give this power, I am giving the key to myself. I am engaging in a contract and henceforth I will be your servant. Now imagine You know, if the devotee was not qualified, he made God dance, then all right, now. Just like Lord Shiv once got entangled in this Bhasmasura-did austerities to attract Lord Shiv. And when Lord Shiv did not manifest, he chopped off his finger. He still did not appear. He chopped off his hand. He still did not come. He chopped off his arm. So finally Lord Shiv said, all right, I have come. What is it you want? So Bhasmasura said, oh God, thank you so much. I want this boon that if I place my hand over anybody's head, his head should burst. So Ashutosh Bhut Bhavan Bhagavan, Bholenath, he said, all right, tathastu. He gave him the boon. So Bhasmasura, equipped with the boon, he said, let me have my first rehearsal on Lord Shiv now. Let me burst his head so that Kailash and Mother Parvati become mine. So he took off after him. Lord Shiv said, my God, I have given him a boon and I am in trouble now. So wherever he would go, the demon would follow him. So finally, Vishnuji intervened. He said that, what are you doing? Don't you know, in most roads in USA, 70 is the speed limit. You're going so fast. He said, he has given me the boon that if I place my hand on anybody's head, it will burst. So Vishnuji said, you fell for his words. Don't you know that he is always intoxicated in madar leaves? First check whether he's actually given it to you or not. He said, you've got a valid point. So how do I check? Place your hand on your head and see what happens. He said, all right, and his head bursts. Shankarji was released. So just like Shankarji gave this boon and got trapped. So if God gives divine love, he's trapped forever and ever. So he doesn't give it easily. That's why Lord Ram, he tells Kagbushundi, Kagbushundi Manguvara Ati Prasanna Mohijana. Kagbushundi, I am very pleased with you. And I am willing to give you whatever you like. So what does he offer? He says, Animadika Siddhi. Do you want mystic abilities? Ability to walk on the water, to transpolate objects, read people's minds. These Siddhis, Aparanidhi, you want opulences? Special powers, talents, abilities. Moksha sakala sukha khan. Do you want liberation from the material energy? Eternal salvation? But very cunningly, he did not name bhakti. He kept bhakti hidden. So he says, moksha sakala sukha khan. The source of all bliss, he's praising moksha, liberation. So Kagbushundi said, my Lord, am I the only fool you have met today? What is it that you are trying with me? God said, Kagbushundi, I'm offering you all these things. You're saying that I'm trying to fool you? My Lord, what you are offering is totally insipid and uninteresting to me. Without that one thing, Bhagatihin guna sab sukh aise lavan bina bahu vyanjan jaise. Just like food without salt is tasteless. You make the tastiest of foods, but don't put salt, and you offer it. Now, if that person is not an accomplished yogi, he will complain. You may say, how is my cooking? He'll say, you know, that's all very well, but you've forgotten the salt. So similarly, my Lord, without your devotion, all that you are offering is zero but a saw. It's a zero out of 100. If you want to give me, I want only one thing. Your parabhakti, your vishuddha bhakti. Your gunatit bhakti, your nishkam bhakti, your aviral bhakti. Aviral bhakti vishuddhatav, shruti puran jehi gav, jehi khojat yogish muni, prabhu prasad kohupav. Which big yogis, ascetics, tapasvis, sadhus, rishis, they search for it all through their lives. They sit on the banks of the Ganges, they become Naga Babas, they engage in Ashwamedh Yajnas, they perform tremendous austerities, apply ashes to their body. How will I get this bhakti? Jehi khojat yogish muni, prabhu prasad ko pav. And it is by your grace that one out of many receives. My Lord, if you wish to be merciful, give me that just one thing. I want nothing else. So God admitted, God was impressed. Sunu vayasa te paramasayana. Kahina mangasi asavaradana. He said, Kagushundi, you are paramasayana. You are very intelligent. Somebody who is intelligent will say, God, give me liberation. But somebody who is very intelligent will say, God, give me divine love. Why? Bhagati karata soi mukati gosai anichita avat bariyai. If you get devotion, liberation is an automatic byproduct. Like one Sufi saint says, Daulat mili hai ishq ki, ab aur kya mile? Wo cheez mil gayi hai jisse khuda mile. So he says, I have got ishq, divine love. What remains? I have got that item by which you get God himself. And everything else is under God. So that divine love is the prized and cherished goal for us human beings. Premavatar Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He said, Purushartha Shiromani Soi Prem Dhan. Purushartha is the effort to attain an object. So the amongst all the attainable objects, the highest attainable object is divine love. So that divine love, you can never get it by your effort. You will only get it by the grace of God and the Guru. So to receive that grace, we will need to prepare ourselves. So this preparation that we do, this is the celebration of Ram Navami, the engaging in kirtan, the hearing and chanting of the glories and knowledge of God. This is all a part of preparatory devotion. So this is called sadhan bhakti and that is called siddh bhakti. So how is siddh bhakti? Perfect divine love? It can never be described. Naradji, the great saint who has written Bhakti Darshan, he says, anirvachaniyam prema swarupam. He is writing a whole scripture on devotion. But when he is asked, how is this devotion? He says, indescribable. Dube so bole nahi, bole so anjana. One who has drowned in it can never describe it. One who is trying to describe is unaware of the depth of this ocean. Gehro prema samudra ko dube chatur sujan. He says this is a fathomless ocean of divine love. And Chatura Sujan, the intelligent person, is able to drown in it. So that divine love is indescribable. It is received by His grace. But it is received when we prepare our vessel, the vessel of our heart. Like Sri Aurobindo said, you must keep the temple of the heart clean if you wish to install therein the living presence. So to prepare our vessel is our job. And to grace with that divine love is the job of God and Guru. So in that preparation, we need to purify our mind, our intellect, and that is where the different aspects of devotion come into play. The Navadha Bhakti, most of you have heard. Navadha Bhakti? Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnosmaranam, Padasevanam, Archanam, Vandanam, Dasyam, Sakhyam, Atmanivedanam. Various aspects of devotion. You could do any one of them or all of them with the idea of purifying your mind, but keeping the one principle of divine love in mind. That one principle, if we don't have, it will disqualify us. And what is that? Jahi na chahiya kab hun kachhu tum san sahaj saneha. If you ask that devotee, why do you engage in devotion? What is it? What self-interest are you trying to fulfill out of it? Are you engaging in devotion because you want material things? Absolutely not. Are you engaging in devotion because you want to be liberated from material bondage? That's puny in front of divine love. Are you engaging in devotion because you wish to see God? That is also insignificant. What do you mean? Seeing God is insignificant in comparison to divine love? Because we see, read in the Puranas that God manifests before Dhruv, before Prahlad, his devotees. And the devotee is crying, oh God, oh God. And finally God comes and he says, I have come. So devotee says, thank you, my Lord. I need something. You need something? I have come. What else do you need? Is there anything bigger than me? So devotee says, my Lord, you are nothing so special. There's something even more special than you. That is your devotion. I want your devotion. So when after meeting God, the devotee asks for divine love, which means this divine love is even higher than God Himself. So that divine love has this one qualification to it. It must be causeless. It must have no tinge of selfishness. We begin the process selfishly motivated because we want happiness, we want this, we want that. But we end the process selfless. Why do we engage in devotion? Not for our sake, but for His sake. Why do we want devotion? Because we wish to serve Him and make Him happy. So if that principle of divine love can be fitted into our heads, that bin mange moti mile, mange mile na bhik. Without asking, you will get everything. And asking, you will never get it. So if we can decide that this devotion is what we want. Saint Francis of Assisi, I like to repeat his quotation. O Lord, let me seek not so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying to the little self that we are born to eternal life. So all the saints in all the traditions of the world who actually ripened their devotion, they realized that devotion is all about giving, giving, giving. So that kind of preparation, if we do, and we, God becomes convinced, the Guru becomes convinced that our vessel is ready, then they will give us that divine love which will make us eternally enriched with the highest possessible object. And that will be the fulfillment of our celebration of the festival of Ram Navami. Siyavara Ram Chandra Bhagavan Ki Jagat Guru Shri Kripaluji Maharaj Ki.